Hello and welcome His House friends, family, and staff to this month's virtual chapel service. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe this page so you can stay up to date to the latest happenings here at His House Children's Home. My name is Jessica and I'm your host for today, and we've got a lot of great things planned for this chapel service. We have live worship and our special guest speaker right from Hollywood Community Church, Pastor Brad Creviston, bringing the word. So we're super excited, glad that you're here. So go ahead, get comfortable as we worship together.
Hey everyone at His House, how's it going? My name is Jonas. I am a local worship leader here in South Florida, and I have the privilege of leading you all in worship today. So please, will you join me? Let's sing praises to our King. Let's lift him up and praise him for how amazing and faithful he is in our lives. So will you please join me in this time of worship?
Who is the way, the truth, the life? Who is the holy word of life?
My chains, all the shackles of my shame.
deliver me from the lies that wreck my heart. Come and lead me from the dark. Father, show how strong you are. Deliver me. Oh, Lord, deliver me. And I will trust in only you. You will bring the victory. Doesn't matter what I see, it doesn't matter what I see. Oh, even when I am afraid, when the world around me shakes, I know you will never change. Oh, deliver me. Oh, Lord, deliver me. And I will trust in only you. You bring the victory. You bring the victory. Oh, and all your promises are true. It doesn't matter what I see. It doesn't matter what I see.
This is truly an honor for me to be sharing a message with you this morning. My name is Brad Creviston, and I'm one of the pastors at Hollywood Community Church, and I've been there for the last 8 years, and I was presented with this opportunity to share a message with you, and I'm super excited to see what God does in your life as His Word is taught and as He speaks to each of you. So would you join with me in a word of prayer? Father in heaven, we give you all the honor and the glory, and Father God, we ask right now that you would block out our distractions, that you would block out any obstacles that keep us from hearing from you, Father God. And we pray that you would open our eyes and our ears to see and to hear what your word is speaking to us, Father. And we pray that your spirit gives us what we need to act on it, to apply it to our lives and be the true people of God. So we love you, and we praise you, and it's in your mighty name we pray, amen. So this morning, how many of you are suffering? And this idea of suffering, it doesn't matter how small you may think your suffering is. It doesn't matter if you think somebody is suffering more than you are. What matters to you is if your suffering It is suffering. And for those of us who maybe are not suffering currently, have you ever endured suffering at some point in your life? And what it begs the question of is, how do we handle suffering when it appears in our lives? What is our first response to this suffering? And for some of us, do we question God? Do we say, God, why do you allow this? Or do we get angry and frustrated and, God, how dare you allow this suffering in my life? Or do you try to end suffering in your own strength? Or do we sit back and we wish that suffering was not a part of our Christian life and something that we would have to endure as the people of God? Church, it would be foolish for me this morning to sit back and say that suffering doesn't exist, that it isn't painful, that it doesn't take long for us as a human to realize that we're going to encounter suffering. Early on in our life, we encounter suffering, and it doesn't take long to get there because there's a world of suffering that each of us endure throughout our lifetime. And here's an important question that we have to ask ourselves. When suffering enters our life, are we satisfied with our response? Are we happy with the way that we respond to suffering? Does our suffering lead us to a mindset of defeat, or does it lead us to victory? Do you long for hope in the middle of your suffering? Well, if you said yes to any of those questions, then you are in good company today, because the Apostle Paul has an answer for just those questions. And that's what we are going to unpack this morning. So if you have your Bible, or if you have the Bible on your app, I would encourage you to turn to Romans chapter 5. And this is where we're going to dive into. We're going to unpack this passage. And I've titled my message this way today. I've titled it, A Royal Paradox. A Royal Paradox. And look at me with verses 3 through 5. And in verse 3, we're going to look at this first part of it. It says, not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings. Not only that. What does he mean by not only that? Well, he's referring to what he just talked about in the first two verses, which we didn't read. But here's what Paul is encouraging with us. That everybody who has placed their faith in Jesus Christ has been justified. Meaning God declares us righteous, blameless, without sin. He has taken our sin, he's condemned it, and he no longer holds our sin against us. And he says, you are justified. You have been given access into God's presence, into this throne room where you stand in this grace. You have become the family of God, and you have access to your Father at any moment through Jesus Christ. And because our faith is in him, we are justified. And then he says, not only that, but you have peace with God. Because the scriptures say, Paul tells us that before Christ, all of us, we were enemies with God. We were hostile towards him. We wanted nothing to do with him. And we shook our fist at him. But it says that when we placed our faith in God, we no longer were enemies. We have become the friends of God, the family of God. And we have this peace, not only with God, but we also have this peace with each other. We are reconciled to one another. We can have unity and we can have peace within the body of Christ. And this is great. This is exciting. And this is beautiful news. That means that if we have peace with God, then that also means that we won't suffer, right? Isn't that what the peace of God means? Is that we'll have peace in our life too? Well, see, this is where the royal paradox comes in. Paul says we have all these blessings of faith and justification, but not only that, we rejoice in our sufferings. Whoa, time out. We have peace with God, and yet we rejoice in our sufferings? Both of those are a paradox. How can this be? Shouldn't our lives be marked by peaceful living and not suffering? But Paul wants us to grasp this reality. He wants us to see that we have peace with God, and we also rejoice in our sufferings. In other words, our lives will include suffering. There will be difficult times. There will be painful moments in our lives. There will be moments of despair. There will be moments of depression. There will be moments of fear. There will be moments of doubt. But Paul wants us to understand that this is a way to rejoice in our sufferings. There is a way to go through suffering and still have a mindset of rejoicing. So how do we do that? Before we get to the how, there's something we need to understand first. And I'm going to start with the end in mind, and then we're going to work our way back to the beginning. And so I mentioned the title of this message is a royal paradox. And we need to understand that royal part first. So if you have your Bible open, turn over quickly to Romans chapter 8, because there's an important part that we have to understand about royal and royalty and what it means to us. Romans chapter 8, verse 18. The Apostle Paul says this. Oops. For I consider the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. There is a glory that is waiting to be revealed to us. Our glory isn't just that we are going to be a light bulb and shine light in the middle of the darkness. Glory means that we will finally be the people of God in the kingdom of priests that God had intended for us to be from the beginning. His people ruling over his creation, reflecting praise and glory back to him. This glory then is our kingship. We are a royal priesthood, as the disciple Peter says in 1 Peter. In other words, our glory means that we ourselves are royalty. Every one of us who has placed our faith in Jesus Christ is a king. Now, flash forward with me to Romans 8, 31 through 39. And this is what the Apostle Paul says. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake, we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. I love what verse 37 says, and it means more, makes much more sense to me now than it ever did before. He says, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Catch this, we are conquerors. You are a conqueror through faith in Jesus Christ. And here's a simple question, who conquers things? Kings do. Kings and their warriors go into battle and they conquer their enemies. When I asked my wife this question, I said, who conquers things? She says, conquerors. And while true, it also is the fact that kings conquer things. And they use their power to overwhelm other people and to enslave them and capture them. And they conquer things. And Paul is here using this same imagery of kings and conquering things. And why? Because we are conquerors. We are kings through Jesus Christ. We are conquering kings. But we don't conquer like the rest of the world does that are without Christ. We don't conquer through pain and suffering and death. What do we conquer then? If we're not conquering people and countries, what do we conquer as God's people? We conquer sufferings. Any kind of suffering we conquer. Paul just gave a list to us of things that we conquer. He says we conquer tribulation. We conquer distress. We conquer persecution and famine and nakedness and danger and sword and even death we conquer. Then right after this verse, it includes in anything else in creation. In other words, anything else that's bad that happens in your life, guess what? You will conquer that through faith in Jesus Christ. You see, when it comes to that suffering in our lives, we need to have a conqueror mindset. We have the Spirit of God who lives within us. And the same Spirit that raised Christ Jesus from the dead lives in us. And we have access to that Spirit's power every single day. And here is the mindset that Paul wants us to have. I wrote it in my notes this way, and you can simply write it as this. We will conquer suffering. We will conquer suffering. You see, we look at the suffering in our lives and we remind ourselves that we will conquer it. It will not defeat us no matter how bad it gets. And at this point, you might say, Brad, this kind of sounds close to a name it and claim it kind of gospel or theology? And here is my response. Name it and claim it. Yes, name your suffering and then claim your suffering. Don't deny it. Don't run from it. Don't hide it. Don't try to say it doesn't exist. Don't try to squash it. Remember that the Holy Spirit will give you victory over that suffering. That suffering cannot and will not defeat you because of the Holy Spirit that is in you. This is not a name it and claim it where you believe God will give you health, wealth, and prosperity. However, I have seen in my own life and many other people's lives that when suffering first enters our lives, we have a defeated mindset. We immediately run to, God, why me? Or how can I overcome this? Or where is my help coming from? Or how do I do this with my own strength? How can I get myself through this? How can I pull myself up on my bootstraps and be able to push through this suffering? How can I do it in my own strength, in my own power, my own might? You know what happens when we do that? It leads us to exhaustion. But here Paul is saying, instead, start with this mindset. We will conquer suffering. And we will conquer through the love and the power of the Holy Spirit. And how does God bring this victory over suffering about? Let's look at Romans 5, 3 through 5. You see, there were many in Paul's day who thought that if you were going through suffering, then that meant that you must have angered some kind of God. And what Paul wants us to understand is that this is not a displeasure from God. That rather, a Christian life is a cross-shaped life. It's one that is marked by suffering. It is one that says trouble is coming into your life. And this is why Jesus told his disciples, he said, in this world you will have trouble, but do not fear, for I have overcome the world. Our lives are a cross-shaped life. There will be suffering. Jesus set the example, and he walked through a life of suffering. But what Paul is about to show us is that when we are suffering, God is working in and through our lives with a purpose. This doesn't mean that God is causing this suffering in your life, but rather when you endure this suffering, he is working his purposes out in you. And what is that purpose? It's the development of these three powerful attributes in our Christian journey. And the first of these is in verse 3. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance. So the first character that God wants us to develop is endurance. And this has the idea of pressing forward as well as staying put without letting despair and depression and frustration overwhelm us. Yes, the suffering will be hard. It will be painful. It will grieve our souls. But God is wanting us to stay firm in our faith in him. He wants us to remember that we will conquer suffering. In other words, whatever it is that we are suffering, we trust every day that God will give us what we need to take a step of faith. Whatever that looks like, we may not feel like God is near, but we draw near to him. We may not feel like God's loving arms are embracing us, but we embrace him through prayer and through reading God's word. When thoughts of defeat or doubt flood our mind, we remind ourselves that God loves us and has given us the victory of suffering. And we will come out the other side of this, whether on this side of heaven or on the other side of heaven. We look at suffering as a marathon, not a sprint. We ask for God's grace for today, and then the next day we wake up and we ask God, God, we need grace. God, we need faith. Help us to stay firm in our faith because he has promised us that we will conquer suffering. The second attribute is this. Look at verse 5. Look at verse 4. He says, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. Paul says suffering produces endurance, and then endurance produces character. What does Paul mean by this? The Greek word for character has this idea, tried and tested, or tested worth, or another way of saying it is as firm as a rock. And have you ever heard somebody say, this person is my rock? What do they mean by that? They mean that this person has demonstrated themselves to be tried and tested, that they have a confidence that cannot be shaken. They can walk through anything, and when trouble comes, they're just a sound mind. They have self-control. They're always trustworthy and they're dependable even in the midst of chaos and trouble. And this is what Paul says God is cultivating in us when we go through suffering. Our faith is tested and tried. And as we move from suffering to suffering, our faith in Christ produces a character within us that is able to embrace any suffering that comes our way. It doesn't mean there won't be pain. Instead, we keep our faith in Christ, and that faith will make us a rock in our life because we have gone through suffering and realized that God is good and God is faithful. And I'm sure you've seen a godly person that has demonstrated this kind of characteristic. They have faith in God. And every time they're going through something difficult, they always say, praise God that he is good, that there is good that's coming out of this. And that is character that God develops through your suffering. So your suffering is never wasted. It makes us people of character. And Paul is telling us that when this character is developed in us, that we see the suffering that enters and we don't fight it. Instead, we trust God that we will conquer suffering. The next characteristic that Paul says that brings into our mind is this, that God is leading us to a destination. He gives us endurance, he gives us character, and then he's leading us to somewhere. And where he's leading us in our suffering is to a destination of hope. And this is such a beautiful truth for us to grasp. So many times we think that in our suffering, God has abandoned us, but God is leading us to hope. And many times in our suffering, we think we're hopeless. We have no hope. We can't trust anything. Everything bad is happening. But God, one of his purposes in your suffering is to push you towards hope in him. And think about that. In your worst suffering, God is leading you to hope. Your heavenly Father is working in your life for your good to bring hope in the midst of your suffering. And this is exactly what Paul says in Romans 5:5. If you look at the verse, it says, and hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. And what is this hope? And why does it not put us to shame? Paul says this about himself in 2 Corinthians. You can look it up later, 2 Corinthians chapter 1. And Paul says this, we do not want you to be unaware, my brothers, of the affliction we experienced in Asia. For we were so utterly burdened beyond our strength that we despaired of life itself. Indeed, we felt that we had received the sentence of death. But that was to make us rely not on ourselves, but on the God who raises the dead. He delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us. On him we have set our hope that he will deliver us again. Paul himself was suffering in Asia. His suffering was so bad that it says that he despaired of life itself. In other words, he said, God, I would rather die than continue to go into this suffering. I would rather just be done with this world. And sometimes we do the same, church. We sit back and say, I'd rather God just take me than leave me here. But Paul says, then he remembered his hope. He remembered that he is a conqueror through Jesus Christ. He said the suffering was to make him rely on God and to rely on the God who raised the dead. In other words, he was to remember that his hope is in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That just as Jesus was raised from the dead, we too would one day be resurrected with him and we would live in glory of God's creation, ruling over it, reflecting praise and glory back to him. And his hope was in the resurrection that Jesus secured for him. So how does hope not put us to shame? Well, first, your salvation, my salvation, is secure in him. We're sealed by the Holy Spirit. Nothing could ever separate us from the love of God. Absolutely nothing. And secondly, suffering with hope shows the world that we aren't ashamed. The world suffers without hope. And the best that they can muster is endurance and character. And they can produce this endurance and character, but at the end of the day, it leads to fatalism and shallow optimism. They have nothing else to hope for. But for us as the family of God, our suffering with hope is a witness to a watching world who's walking around in darkness. And we have a hope. We have a hope that whether on this life or the next, that we will have this victory over suffering. We have hope in the resurrection. And how does God produce this hope in me? How does he produce it in you? Through the Holy Spirit. He pours his love for us into our hearts, tells us we are loved by God. And he also fills our hearts with the love for him. And during our suffering, we cling to our love for God and his goodness to us. We are able to love the Lord our God with our heart, soul, mind, even during our suffering, even if it means death. And I'll end with this story of a man who displayed this kind of hope even in the midst of suffering. There's this man named John Bradford. And he lived during the 1500s, and he went around preaching the gospel, and he was put into prison for preaching the gospel. And it says that he had such a great impact on the prison guards that even the community where he had a large congregation, even while being in prison, he would preach from prison and had a huge church following. And he gained such a reputation for being a man of Christ and a man of character that they would let him go and see any of his congregants who were in trouble. And it says that they told him, as long as you come back before curfew, you can go out and do this. And so they let him out, and he'd come back before his curfew ended. And it said that the prison guards and even some of his friends would come to him and say, look, you can get out of prison if you just renounce your faith in Jesus Christ. Just say you don't believe in him anymore. You'll be set free. You get to go out of this prison. You'll get to live. And he never wavered. He did not care if he was in chains or not. He would not cancel his faith in Jesus Christ. He kept it firm and strong because Jesus was his hope. And one day he got word that he was going to die, that he would be burned at the stake. And it says the morning of the day that he was going to be brought out, him and another young man that he was partners with in the gospel got down on their face, prostrated before God, and prayed for an hour straight. And after an hour, the people got him up and they tied them up to the stake. And before that, he took the wood that he was about to be burned with and he kissed it. Then he went up to the stake that he was going to be attached to and he kissed it. And it says that when he had him changed, he looked out amongst the crowd that was gathered and he said, oh, England, England, repent. And then he turned to the young man who was to suffer with him. He said, be of good comfort, brother, for we shall have a happy supper with the Lord tonight. Then embracing the wood of his execution, he repeated our Savior's words. Straight is the gate and narrow is the way that leads to life, and few there are that find it. You see, this man knew that even though he was about to go through immense physical suffering, that his hope was not in the present circumstances of this world. His hope was in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that his last breath on earth would be his first breath in heaven with his Savior, where they would eat together and dine together. You see, the Christian life is marked with sufferings. It's a royal paradox. Yet we will conquer suffering through the love that fills our hearts through the precious Holy Spirit. This is our challenge. Stay firm. We are conquerors, and we conquer suffering through our hope in Jesus Christ. Join with me in prayer. Father God, we ask that you would make us people of character, that no matter what suffering we go through, Father God, that we would have a conqueror mindset, that you will give us victory over their suffering, Father God, and that our hope is in your resurrection, that we will see a victory, Father God, and you have already secured it through Jesus' death and resurrection. We love you, Father, and it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Brad, for that very timely word. I know that there are a lot of us going through just difficult circumstances right now, most especially with this pandemic. And my prayer today for all of you really is that you are blessed by this word and that you are encouraged and given a hope for the opportunities they get to speak with the children here on campus. The goal here is always to share that message of hope, to bring hope to these children who are going through such difficult times, and it's hard for them, and most especially with this pandemic, all the uncertainties and whatnot. But thanks to partners and donors in the community, we're able to keep our children safe, healthy, and calm during this season, and we thank you all for that. Just a few announcements before we close out our service today. We have foster parent training. If you've ever considered or want to learn more about our foster parent training program, just go ahead and reach out to us at the very end of this video. We have some slides with some information on that. But if you want to learn more, or if finally you want to take that next step and start your training to become a foster parent, go ahead and reach out to us with that information on that slide. Secondly, for those of you who don't know me, I also run the student ministry here at His House Children's Home. It's called the 180 Student Ministry. We host games, activities, services, like your typical church youth group, but just for the children here on campus. And so many children have been moved over the last 5 years that we have been around. So you can actually check in and see what we've been doing with the children during this time through our virtual services that have been happening on YouTube as well. You can just go ahead and just search in YouTube 180 Student Ministry and you'll find our content there. We definitely appreciate your support. And for more information on that ministry, you can certainly reach out to me, Jessica Barrera. And finally, lastly, we are launching our match campaign. For those of you who have been around His House for a while, every year we have a match campaign. And this year's campaign is called Hearts and Minds. And the beauty of this match campaign is that every dollar that is donated during this match campaign period is gonna be matched dollar for dollar. That's a huge impact that you can have on the lives of these children, allowing us to meet all their basic needs and create memories for these children that can last them a lifetime. So if you want to be a part of that, check out the information on the slide for a link to the page where you can make your donation. Again, it is matched dollar for dollar, so every dollar counts, no matter how little or how large. And with that, that's the conclusion of our August virtual chapel service. We thank you so much. We pray that you are blessed. We pray that you stay safe. We love you guys, and we'll see you next month. And don't forget, wash your hands.